We had a family reunion this summer and all of our grandchildren came home. And oh, it was one of the most wonderful, wildest times I ever saw. And when I'd get tired, I'd say, oh, I've got to go back and study a few minutes. And I'd go back and lie down a few minutes and then come out for some more. But you know, I love those children. It was great.
I've had this home for many years. And I've had a wonderful family that God has given me and my wife. And as I think back over the years, I'm in a state of thankfulness. I see how God's hand guided me. When I began preaching many years ago, it was not with any thoughts that I'd be preaching to large audiences.
Come to the cross. His gospel is for everyone.
God has done this.
Christ is alive. In modern America today, there is a vacuum of the soul.
Our country's in great need of a spiritual awakening. Well, there have been times that I've wept as I've gone from city to city and I've seen how far people have wandered from God. Of all the things that I've seen and heard, there's only one message that can change people's lives and hearts.
There is a way if you come by the way of the cross.
But Billy Graham, one of the most inspirational spiritual leaders of the 20th century.
We need you, we love you. Thank you for coming, Billy Graham.
Would you welcome, please, evangelist, author, educator, Dr. Billy Graham.
Our recipient, the man who honors us by being here today.
What is your purpose?
Go into the whole world and proclaim this message.
You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
Shall make you free.
We all die. I'm not going to escape it. I don't want to escape it. I want to go. The vast majority of my life has already been lived. My record has already been made. I don't have very much longer. I know that.
Some of my closest friends and relatives, and especially my wife, are already in heaven. I want to tell people about the meaning of the cross. Not the cross that hangs on a wall or around someone's neck. They not only put nails in his hands, but before that, they scourged him. A Roman scourge was a terrible thing. They took whips and pellets on those whips and beat a person almost to death. He shed his blood, and the shedding of that blood carries with it God's very life. But that was not the real suffering. The real suffering is when he said, "My God, why hast thou forsaken me?" In that terrible moment, he and God the Father were separated.
The Bible talks about heaven as a holy city, a perfect environment in which a perfect society dwells. Heaven will be a place in which its inhabitants will be freed from the fears and insecurities that plague and haunt us in the present life. And the scripture says, "And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there will be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are all passed away, and we enter a new world." You say, "Well, Billy, what in the world do I have to do?" First, you must repent of your sins. The Apostle Peter said, "Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins be blotted out." What does repentance mean? Repentance means that you come to God and say, "God, I'm sorry I've sinned." And then you must come by faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please Him. The word faith means that you totally trust. The scripture says in Romans 4, "To him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness." Then the Bible says, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, not of works, lest anyone should boast. If you can work your way to heaven, you'd get up to heaven and boast to everybody. Look what I did. I was such a good person. I got here on my own. You get there totally because of Christ.
Spirit and is given.